Flames have taken their shots at the Islanders every now and then, as the Flames tried last night, but the Islanders so often have the last word. They did. 41 wins for the Islanders now. Tonight, they play the Hurricanes at the Coliseum. Next.
The sun is shining warmly on the Coliseum as the fans and players are all pumped up for tonight's game in Uniondale. The Islanders are hosting the Carolina Hurricanes for their final game of the season, and it will look to make a season sweep for the Islanders, winning all four. John Tavares usually attracts plenty of attention for his on-ice performance, but pay extra attention this evening. The captain already has 2 goals and 5 assists against Carolina this year. He'll look to net his 30th goal of the season in front of a packed barn tonight. Hello everyone, welcome inside Nassau Coliseum. I'm Shannon Hogan. Puck drop between the Islanders and the Hurricanes moments away from right now here on MSG+. The Islanders have won 20 of their last 26 home games here at the Coliseum. They've been feeding off the energy the crowd brings every time they're here at the barn, and they'll look to do the same this evening as well and to pick up 2 points. If Brock Nelson plays any way he's played the last 3 times they've faced Carolina, they should be in good shape. And for more on him and tonight's matchup, let's go up to the booth and welcome in Howie Rose and Butch Goring.
All right, Shannon, thank you, and give our best to Popeye again, and we'll be seeing him in our intermission. But as far as Brock Nelson is concerned, he's got to be happy to see the Carolina Hurricanes in town because he's had some kind of 3 games against them.
Well, we always talk about how certain teams seem to be good luck charms. Well, for Brock Nelson, it's the Carolina Hurricanes. Scored 6 points, 3 goals in his first 2 games, and he was off to a torrid start, and then he slowed down just a little bit. But he saw the Hurricanes not all that long ago, and that started him again feeling much better about himself. And now he's starting to score some goals in a lot of different ways, Howie. So it's pretty interesting how the luck sort of runs here and there with Carolina Hurricanes. If I'm a betting man, he'll score tonight.
Yeah, especially when you look down at the bottom of the screen and you see his body of work against these Hurricanes in 3 previous games this season. Now, the Carolina Hurricanes are not the team that won the Stanley Cup in 2005-2006. They appear destined to miss the playoffs again this year. One guy who was there when they won the Cup, one of only two along with Eric Staal, is their outstanding goaltender, Cam Ward.
Yes, and he's played 500 games, and you're right, Howie. He does have a Stanley Cup. He also has a Conn Smythe in his back pocket. And because you play enough times, you get a little from the Hall of Famer Ronnie Smith, you get a Ronnie Francis, excuse me, you get a silver stick. But this is a guy that competes night in and night out. He's got tremendous skills. He tracks the puck as well as anybody in the National Hockey League. He's an athletic goaltender. He makes spectacular saves at different times, and he gives his team a chance to win each and every time. So the Islanders are going to have to work hard if they hope to win this game tonight.
It's a nice milestone earlier in the week for Cam Ward, as you saw just moments ago. Hurricanes made a player move earlier today. They dealt for former Islander defenseman Jack Hillen. From the Washington Capitals, Tim Gleason goes the other way. And Hillen, as you see, in the building, good to go. He didn't land until a little after 3 o'clock this afternoon. But he's here, and for the Islanders, Cal Clutterbuck will tell you there is justice. After being denied a goal last night on a controversial call, he came up with one into an empty net, helping the Islanders defeat the Calgary Flames. Tonight, it's the Islanders and the Carolina Hurricanes for the final time this year. That's how the season started. The Islanders won 2 in a row against the Hurricanes in October. One more last week in Raleigh. They'll drop the puck on the island right after this.
Early evening hockey here at Nassau Coliseum. It's a 5 o'clock start. The Islanders hosting the Carolina Hurricanes for their 4th and final meeting of the season. Closed captioning is brought to you by the New York Lottery. Hey, you never know. And while we have some time, let's take a look at the Lexus upcoming schedule. The Islanders finishing out their homestand this evening against Carolina, and then they're heading out for their longest remaining road trip. It'll be just over a week. They're going to start in Dallas, playing the Stars. That's Tuesday at 8:30, and that'll be on MSG+2. Then the Predators are in town, or they're playing the Predators at 8, followed by the Panthers and the Maple Leafs. Somehow the weather there won't be as nice as Florida, I think. And now for Puck Drop, let's go up to the booth and welcome in Howie and Butch. Guys.
All right, Shannon, thanks very much. So the Carolina Hurricanes, formerly the Hartford Whalers, make their final appearance at the Nassau Veterans Memorial Coliseum. And Chad Johnson, a very important part of what the Islanders have done over the last few weeks, in goal for New York. this evening will be opposed at the other end by Cam Ward. Of course, Ward, Stanley Cup experience, Johnson last year, big year with the Boston Bruins, albeit as the backup, of course, for Tuukka Rask. But with the emergence of Johnson now, Yaroslav Halak can lessen the load a little bit. Everybody should be fresh by playoffs.
Yeah, and this is a big move for the Islanders to be able to play Johnson on a regular basis and get whatever goaltender they decide to go with, which is likely Halak in the playoffs. Cam Ward, 17-4-3 against the Islanders, Howie, so he's had pretty good success.
Well, the Islanders are starting Nelson between Kuhlman and Clutterbuck. Hickey and Hamonic are once again a defense pair tonight. Lubomir Visnovsky is a healthy scratch as they continue to manage his workload. Brian Strait back in on defense a little bit later on. And Hurricanes starting out with the Stahl brothers and Alex Semin. That puck goes out of play. Hainsey on defense along with Falk.
Well, you mentioned Stahl brothers. That's one of my keys, how he's defending the Stahl brothers and Semin. They were very good last game against the Islanders. Falk Hainsey, that's going to be the matchup if the Hurricanes have their way against John Tavares. So we'll see how Jack Capuano handles that. And in the neutral zone management, Hurricanes were very good against the Caps in the neutral zone, so the Islanders will have to manage that puck coming through that particular area.
And those starting lineups are brought to you by Infiniti Luxury Cars that deliver inspired performance. So for the Islanders now, it's Nick Leddy working it up the middle. Tavares, Lee, and Bailey, the Islander forwards here. Anders Lee slips it in. Tavares reaching for it. John looks for Bailey going down the boards. Hurricanes fail to clear, and Boychuk lofts one to the net, and that's stopped by Ward.
Ward wanting to make sure he could slow the game down as much as possible. He could have easily moved it. Ward is very, very good with moving the puck. He credits Tom Barrasso with working with him when he was younger and how to move the puck. As we all recall, Tom Barrasso was very good with the puck.
Now the faceoff deep in the Carolina zone, and the Islanders go with Franz Nielsen between Grabner and Strome. And he draws with Riley Nash, number 20. Jeff Skinner, number 53. Elias Lindholm, number 16. Up front for Bill Peters, Carolina Hurricanes, and Skinner snaps one wide. Skinner's had a hot hand lately, a backhander stopped by Johnson. He has scored goals in three straight games as Skinner. And shot stopped by Johnson as well.
Six goals in his last eight games, Howie, the former number one pick.
There's Nielsen with a soft backhander that's stopped by Warren. That's what Skinner does. He's had concussion problems, of course, but when he's healthy, he can put it away.
You know, Bill Peters was talking about Skinner later this afternoon, actually, and about Skinner and saying, you know, showing him video, hey, you want to stay on the outside, you're not going to score. You want to go to those dirty areas, get inside, you're going to score. Just watch the videos of yourself or anybody else in the National Hockey League. You don't score if you're playing outside the dots. Guess he's got the message, Howie, because he's scoring goals.
Well, he is talented, so it's not a surprise to see him playing well again. Islanders retrieve the puck. Gail Mollerat, number 48, throws it in. He's on the fourth line here with Martin and McDonald. DeHaan working on defense with Brian Strait.
Hurricane skated very well against the Capitals yesterday's game. As play with as much speed as I've seen them play at any time during this season.
That was a 3-0 win for them behind Anton Hudobin.
Yeah, who played well but wasn't challenged all that much. He wasn't the difference maker. Capitals just couldn't keep up and couldn't get through the neutral zone on the Hurricanes.
So Mikhail Jordan, number 47, winds it around the boards. And Semin brings it into the Islander zone. Let's go a long drive. Johnson juggles. Rebound pushed wide as Chad Johnson failed to hold that puck or take better control of it and almost got burned.
Yeah, he had a good hard look at it, but he just couldn't seem to handle it. Maybe it had a lot of spin on it.
And now Lee onside into the Hurricane zone for Tavares. He's bottled up by a pair of Hurricanes. Jordan Stahl, number 11, flings it towards his brother Eric, number 12, got tangled up with Hamonic. And now Hickey up the left wing. Lee was well covered by Brett Bellamore, number 73. And Ward feeds it ahead. 3 minutes gone in the opening period. Hurricanes have registered the first four shots. Nathan Gerby throws it in front, and Johnson makes a save on a quick wrister by Andre Nestrosil, number 15.
Looked like Kirby just lost the puck, and the puck found its way onto the slot area. Nestrosil was in that area. There's the shot right there, a long shot. Chad Johnson just didn't handle it. He got to do a lot better control. I mean, yes, Semin can shoot. It was a knuckleball, but good job by Josh Bailey coming back and protecting that rebound, that opportunity by Staal. The Islanders have to get their focus going. However, they've been very good this season with having strong first periods. But this is a team that sometimes you have trouble getting up against.
And from the draw, Belmore gets a shot on the Johnson stuff.
And they need to get their focus in quickly, because certainly the Hurricanes have played very well since the January, the new year, if you will, and a lot more smiles on this guy's face since January rolled around. He's got a much healthier team. But don't underestimate the Hurricanes. They can skate, and they're playing pretty well right now.
They've had the first six shots. Islanders do not have one, but remember, the Islanders have struck early very often recently, scoring the first goal in 10 of the last 12 games. Set up the middle, Riley Nash, number 20, gathers it back in. Chasing Boychuk back into his own end, trailed by Lindholm, who applies the body. Nash back to the puck, out to the blue line now, Hillen wrist shot, and that's gloved and held by Johnson. So another faceoff coming up in a first period, during which in the first 3 minutes and 30 seconds has been full of faceoffs.
Yeah, a lot of shots towards Chad Johnson. Nothing terribly difficult for him. We've been able to kind of get himself into the game. You can see that he's been able to track the puck, establish good position, and for the most part control the rebounds.
So from the draw, the Islanders control. DeHaan looking to send Kuhlman ahead. And Kuhlman from the red line slips it in. Belmore being chased by McDonald. And the Hurricanes should come out here with Belmore throwing it up the middle. And Jay McClement, number 18, flips it into the corner. McClement tried to get it to the front of the net. That was pounded off the boards. And Kuhlman chases Belmore.
Molly, I talked about that matchup with Hainsey and Falk. John Tavares on a different line, a fourth line, if you will. Without Hainsey or Falk on the ice. Jack Capuano, recognizing what's going on, is going to do some experimenting.
Seems like he's been a little more proactive in that department recently. Chance in front denied by Johnson. Eric Staal with a good chance.
Good save by Chad Johnson as he's able to stay with Staal as he was going from left to right. Staal trying to go five hole, was able to cover up low. Well, Chad Johnson, plenty of shots early on, has had to be sharp, and he has been. Again, lucky, tracks the puck, watches it, slides down, takes away the low part of the ice, good reflexes there, and then clears that rebound.
Well, the Hurricanes have really carried the play in the first 4.5 minutes. They have all 8 shots, and they have out-attempted the Islanders, Corsi fans, 13-2.
The Islanders really haven't, and not only that, Howie, they haven't really been out of their own zone.
Quite often it's been the other way around early in games for the Islanders. Dustin Falk wrists one. It's blockered aside. Johnson takes a tumble. He might have actually helped that along a little bit.
Looked like as he went to make the save, he bumped into Staal. Anything would have happened towards the net, probably would have been called a penalty.
Nielsen a quick shot, and that's snatched away by goaltender Cam Ward. And speaking of goaltenders, want to take a minute here to congratulate former Islanders goaltender, now a colleague of ours, of course, here on MSG, Rick DiPietro. He and his wife Cassie became parents for the first time earlier today, after Cassie was in labor for well over 40 hours. And I was texting Ricky earlier. I said, did you decide on a name yet? He said, still haven't decided. I thought I'd be better at this. I said, you only had 9 months. He said, poor planning. Very disappointed with myself. But let's face it, it's Cassie's call anyway, so.
Yeah, I don't know why you're asking him. He's not going to have any say when it's all said and done. Cassie's going to make that decision. She wears the pants in the family, no doubt about it.
And Ricky admitted that in those exact words on the air, on the text. So congratulations,
yes, congratulations,
Rick and Cassie DiPietro. It is a boy.
Yes.
We know that.
He told me that a couple of weeks ago, that he knew what he was having, or what his wife, more succinctly, was having. Mm-hmm.
Just never understood. You've got 9 months to figure a name. Nelson, a shot stop.
He's a goalie. That's the only way I can
Narrow it down for you.
Here's Kirby in over the line. He put one off a leg that ricochets into the corner. Hickey dropped his stick. He's got it now as Hamannik handles the puck. He's under pressure from Victor Rask, number 49, and now it's Kirby. For Rask, he let it go to the blue line. Long drive by Lyles. John Michael Lyles was blocked away. And Hickey plays it into the Carolina zone.
Hurricanes have all the legs right now. The Islanders second best on most everything they're doing. Except for the goalie. He's been sharp.
Nick Leddy plays it out of the zone. This will have to be grabbed by Hainsey in the Carolina end of the ice. It's still February. We've got California on the brain. Meantime, the Hurricanes rescue the puck. Skinner trying to dance out from behind. Can't get there.
Had enough of the winner already, Howie.
Yeah. Grabner checked in center.
Now that's exactly what I was talking about, controlling the neutral zone. Hurricanes did such a good job on the Washington team yesterday. That's exactly what happened way too often as far as Barry Trotz is concerned.
So Tavares puts the pressure on Hainsey. And the puck worked up the left side and all the way down. And that'll go for an icing against the Hurricanes. So they'll bring the draw back into the Carolina zone.
I'm waiting for Chad Johnson to go over to the bench and say, guys, I'm warmed up. I'm ready. I'm all warmed up. Let's make something happen. Again, watch for Michael Grabner as he's going to come through the middle of the ice on this exchange. That we'll get to it a little bit later. But Hurricanes very, very good. Very structure in the neutral zone.
McDonald throws it in front looking for Martin. Well, Martin went into the net. The puck didn't, and there's no further play. Martin, a little slow to get up. And hopefully he's okay. 12:59 remaining in the first period. Drive into the net. No puck, no red light, and no score. Tonight on MSG, you can catch J.B. Smoove along with his guests, the new Pappy, Rick DiPietro, Rashad Jennings, Kurt Metzger, and Dave Attell on an all-new episode of Four Courses with J.B. Smoove tonight at 11 p.m. after the Knicks, presented by Cadillac. I cannot tell a lie. Yes, it was taped. Ricky's not bailing on Cassie just after having a baby to hang out with J.B. Smoove. But anyway, mentioned Jack Hillen played with the Islanders previously and got off a plane at about a quarter after three at LaGuardia earlier today, and now he's playing defense for these Carolina Hurricanes, and that's got to be kind of difficult when you haven't even had a chance to shake hands with your teammates and you're on the ice for warm-ups.
Hey, not much introductions going on, although the guys, you know, they have a little familiarity with one another.
Nielsen pulled down. There's going to be a penalty here to center.
Tough call there because it really wasn't a hook. Looked like it was just stick got caught up with Franz Nielsen. But they get back to Jack Hillen. No, they didn't have a nameplate for him, Howie. They could have easily walked down the hall and got one from the Islanders. They got a nameplate for him.
Yeah, you would think. But he's simply known as the new guy.
Yeah, well, I'll go get him the Jack Hillen Islander one and just put a little tape over the Islander logo. Would have worked fine. But the Islanders, a chance to go on their power play. And it hasn't been very good as of late.
7:28, the time of the penalty. Islanders 5 out of 10 this year on the power play against Carolina, who have the best penalty killing unit in the National Hockey League.
And their penalty kill has been really good. 18 of 19 in their last 19 games, or last 9 games, Holly. So
10 straight
yes.
In their last 4.
Some teams have been really good on their PK.
Tavares looks for Leddy. Tavares under a lot of pressure. And the puck cleared all the way down by Hainsey. And this Islanders power play is brought to you by the New York Lottery. Hey, you never know.
Calgary came in here with a pretty good record, 13 straight games, and the Islanders took care of that. Let's see if they can do the same favor for the
Tavares to Nielsen. He was bottled up, and the Hurricanes get rid of it. So 1:08 remaining to the power play, and the Islanders are changing. Tavares remains on for the moment. As Leddy carries the puck. Travis Hamannik dumps it in. Kuhlman and Nelson are on now. And again, the Hurricanes clear, and the Islanders have got nothing going here. Puck deflected, so Johnson came out to help out.
Poor entries for the Islanders. Got to be able to chip that puck in where you can get it back and make sure you have your guys going with speed.
37 to go to the power play. Ainsley behind the net. At the blue line, it's Hamonic, but he kind of flubs it. Manages to find Bailey. Now the return. Across to Boychuk. Kuhlman knocked down. 18 to the power play. And again, the Hurricanes clear.
Hurricanes with all kinds of pressure. Again, that seems to be the thing, the way, I guess, to kill penalties, not only for the Islanders, but against everybody. Put pressure on the opposition. Don't allow them time or space to get your head up and make a good play.
Well, that power play went nowhere. Islanders did not get a shot. Now McDonald at even strength fires a long one. It's held by Ward.
A little turnover by Gerby. Well, we're talking about the power play for the Islanders. And, of course, Jack Capuano realizes just how important it is. Cam Ward really wasn't tested, but they haven't scored two power play goals in the game for almost 2 months now. But 3 for 28, that's just a little over 10%. And that just isn't going to get the job done. And Cappy talked about that. He said, you've got to go to the net and you got to shoot the puck. Well, that seems pretty simple enough.
As terrific a season as the Islanders have had, and the Hurricanes have iced the puck here, if anything concerns you headed towards the playoffs, it's got to be the special teams, both of them.
Yeah, absolutely, because they can play such a huge role. I mean, they can be momentum swings. They can be game winners. And Howie, let's go back to 2 years ago when they played the Pittsburgh team. That was the reason they didn't, the only reason they didn't beat Pittsburgh. They dominated them 5-on-5, but Pittsburgh was better in the special teams.
Well, from the faceoff, the Islanders keep it with Hamonic wristing one that goes wide. The Barris line is on. Bailey working along the boards. Bailey being worked over himself there a bit by Hillen. But now Bailey snaps it off the stick of Jack Hillen.
Good job by Lee controlling those boards and winning those battles.
The puck came out, so the Islanders have to tag up. The late offside is now wiped as the Islanders do tag.
Anders Lee is not just a goal scorer. He's pretty strong along the boards, does great corner work. Got much better at playing that part of the game.
9:40 to go in the opening period. Hurricanes had the first 10 shots. They've outshot the Islanders 11-3. And that puck carries into the seats and out of play. So the Islanders have had a power play. They did not manage a shot. And we remain scoreless. Tonight's GEICO hometown hero is U.S. Army Colonel Mark A. Rado from Carle Place, New York, right near the Coliseum. Colonel Rado enlisted in the Army in 1985 and currently serves in the Pentagon in Washington, D.C., working in support of the Army's Uniformed Chief of Military Personnel. We salute Colonel Mark Rado and thank him for his service.
Absolutely. Carle's Place, that's where the train stops. Now we have been on the train several times, just before Westbury. Carle's Place stop. Right there. Close to the Coliseum. You're 100% right.
We'll really be getting used to the train next year, won't we?
Oh, boy.
Here's Martin wheeling out of the zone. Looking on right wing for McDonald. Didn't reach him. Puck sits along the boards. And Nathan Gerby comes to center. Former Buffalo Sabre.
Very strong on his feet. He's only about 5'5", Howie. But he's built like a Hercules type of guy and very, very strong. Down low, doesn't get pushed over.
He played against a little guy named Bobby Lalonde.
Yep, about the same size.
Remind you of him?
Yeah, very much so. Bobby Lalonde, terrific shot. Played for the Montreal Canadiens, Vancouver Canucks. He could skate like the wind. Much like Gerby. Hey, you got to be able to skate pretty fast. You got to be awful quick on your feet to be able to play the game at that particular size. It wouldn't matter whether you're in the 60s, 70s, 80s, or even in today. You still have to be quick to be able to play when you're a smaller guy.
Lindholm works it into the Islanders zone, wound around by Letty. The Islanders fail to clear, though. Said that a few times in this period.
A lot of turnovers for the Islanders.
Grabner with speed, shooting, he scores! His seventh goal of the year. The Islanders lead it 1-0.
Michael Grabner using his speed. We talked about him not being at 100% possibly, Howie, but we could see the acceleration of Michael as he drives wide. Nice pass as he swings to the outside, takes a little look. And look at him churn, get those feet moving, and the beautiful wrist shot. Ward was in perfect position, but he just snapped that one over his glove. That was a tremendous shot by Michael. Knew where he was going, but I love the acceleration. You get the feet moving, never thought about it, anything else other than let me go as fast as I can and see if I can't get a little wide and get an opportunity.
So despite being outplayed, here are the Islanders now scoring first for the 11th time in their last 13 games.
Perhaps this will get them a little bit more motivated, Howie, if I possibly can.
It certainly got the crowd into it. Lutterbuck working behind the net. Nelson trying to squeeze through, but not. And the Hurricanes work it to center.
And the fans are into it now, Howie. They've been pretty quiet. Woke them up also.
Strom and Boychuk get the assists at 11:47. Nobody controls it in the corner. McClement against Kuhlman there. A lot of talk that McClement might be on the move by Monday. Clement working behind the Carolina goal line.
Now this is the time where you don't send your laundry out unless you're John Tavares and people like that.
Jack Hillen, who found that out today, wrists it around the board. He was going from a team likely to make the playoffs, the Washington Capitals, that won, who probably will not, the Carolina Hurricanes. And Hillen's are an unrestricted free agent at the end of the year, so this may well be a very short stay in Carolina for Jack Hillen.
And an opportunity to just establish himself as a 5-6 defenseman in the National Hockey League. And nothing wrong with having that kind of career.
Offensive style defenseman.
Yes.
Now Lee tried to play it across. That hit Jordan Staal, number 11 for Carolina. His brother Eric now tussles with Hamonic. They get there together. Jordan Staal got it loose. Staal protects it. Now for his brother Eric. Hamonic all over him. Simmons loose as well, looking for the puck. Mickey got it away. Simmons recovers. And now Bailey for Tavares. And the Islanders come in 3-on-2. Bailey gathers it back. Bailey pulls up, throws it right through the crease. The trailer, DeHaan, hustles to the boards. Feeds Lee, or pardon me, Tavares. And that missed. Straight. So Brian Straight under siege here from Gerby. Great job by Gerby to keep the heat on, but the Islanders recover, and now it's Tavares with 5:44 remaining in the period. DeHaan back in the Islanders zone.
One of the areas that Bill Peters was worried about the Islanders was transition. We just saw a bit of that as they came up the ice. Three abreast, great pass from Tavares over to Bailey, and a good opportunity at the net.
Johnson leaves it for DeHaan, who nearly gave it away. Estrasil couldn't hold on to it, so Martin flips it in, but the Islanders ahead of the play and offside. So we'll pause. 5:18 remaining, first period. Michael Grabner breaks through. 1-0 Islanders.
We always talk about Ryan Strome's ability to see something and make it happen in a hurry. That's the circle players, Ryan Strome. Michael Grabner, watch him come across, follow the arrow. Good speed, and then he just gets those feet moving, goes to the outside, and in the quick wrist shot over the glove of Cam Ward. But again, tremendous puck movement by the Islanders, and boy, talk about speed, Michael Grabner. But I love the pass from Strome to Grabner.
We know Strome is now the Islanders' plus-minus leader at plus 22. And he was coming into this game anyway, but that's by nice little margin over the closest pursuer, Travis Hamonic, plus 16. So all the Hurricanes to center now. Lindholm, number 16.
Good job by Letty on Lindholm, refusing to have him any time to make the pass.
Hurricanes offside there. Didn't necessarily look it, but Riley Nash brought it in ahead of the play with 4:51 remaining in the first period.
Riley Nash, 22 points last year, was his career high. Mind you, just a young guy at 24 points. He's an Oilers draft pick. Getting an opportunity to show his stuff, good size.
Now Hillen races back to get it, but Ward goes to a more familiar face, Jordan. Or it's, I don't recognize you. I'm not giving you the puck. Eric Staal shoots one. Johnson gets a piece of it. He didn't trust that white jersey, did he?
No, he did not. Must have turned the puck over before.
Brock Nelson working against Semin. Jordan Staal's wraparound stopped by Johnson, but he's lost his stick. Chant Johnson without a goal stick. Hamonic sweeps it back to him, so Johnson's now put back together. And the puck along the near boards for Eric Staal.
Good job by Travis Hamonic. The awareness.
Not held at the blue line there by Hillen. So away goes Clutterbuck. Hits the trailer, but Nelson fans. Clutterbuck got a shot to the side of the net. And Ward's able to cover up. And Clutterbuck, who missed an empty net once last night before finally scoring into it from a more difficult angle, almost had one here.
Yeah, he had a wee spot. Clutterbuck, a great pass to Brock Nelson. He fans on it. Nothing really there as Cam Ward has got his skate right up against the post. Horrendous opportunity. I'm surprised Brock didn't one-time it. Held on to it, tried to wrist it. One-timer would have been better served. The quicker you get it, the quicker the release, the less chance that the goaltender can react. Matter of fact, Cam Ward said, that's the difference between the good goal scorers and the great goal scorers. It's all in the release. You give me time to set up, I'll stop you.
Now Tavares set for the faceoff against Rask. 3:54 to go in the first period. 1-0 Islanders on Grabner's goal. DeHaan in deep. Shouldered into the boards mildly by Nesprasil. And DeHaan pushes it to the corner. Lee one-hands it back to Tavares. Barron right to the side of the net. Lee put it in front. Bailey lost it on a stick check just as Josh was getting ready to pull the trigger.
Nice defensive play by Justin Falk. He used his stick to poke check Bailey. Is right, tremendous opportunity for Josh Bailey.
There's DeHaan into the zone. Trying to get it to Bailey. Josh finds it now. And Bailey tried to wheel it around the boards. That hit something. And stays in. So Tavares, surrounded, finds Lee. Yes, couldn't reach it. Three Hurricanes angle right to John Tavares.
And Nesterson turned it over.
Falk just looked like he was slashed. Falk talking about that to the referee. I think it was Bailey who got him. But either way, Falk appears a little hurt. 27 for Carolina. DeHaan throws it at the net. That's blocked away. And Hainsey just flips it back into the Islander zone.
Well, they're starting to warm up to the task. It took them about 10 minutes to get themselves involved in the game, but they started to pick up the pace and spend a little more time in the offensive zone.
Shots are now 15-6 Carolina. Hurricanes had the first 10. Carolina back in. Terry put it out in front. It goes in. I'm not sure if McClement made contact with that or not. But as Johnson left the room, the puck slithered through, and the Hurricanes have tied it 1-1. Now, they may check to see if
they will.
That was directed in with a skate.
It did go in off the skate. I'm not sure if he directed it in, but it definitely goes in off the skate of McClement. So we'll wait and see. They're going to look at this. There's no doubt about it. Let's just see if he kicks it any kind of... Oh, that's
you can make a case.
Yeah,
there.
That's definitely... I think that's going to be called back because that is a forward motion with the skate. I would be, Mike Murphy and crew will take a little look at it, but for me, it wasn't a huge kick, but it's a slight push of the skate, Howie. You can see he angles his skate and then he pushes it forward just a little bit. Watch the skate go towards, there it is. Yeah. See the heel turn out, the bottom of the heel turns out towards the net. So I'm thinking you got to call that one back. I'm not trying to be a homer, but the heel moves towards the net, and I don't know that you can do that.
Well, they are discussing it, not only at the scorer's table, but in Toronto as well. The crowd is chanting no goal. You can make up your own mind.
And the key is to watch the heel of the skate turn towards the net. It doesn't, if he holds his foot steady, then it's probably going to be a good goal. But the fact you move your skate towards the net, in this case it's the heel, that to me is a kicking motion towards the net. Trying to help those guys in Toronto.
Well, all that's left to do is wait for them to make up their minds, unless you did influence them. But you can tell Graham Skilleter, the referee, is simply waiting for what they're going to tell him to make his ruling.
Yeah, and watch the left foot and watch the heel turn. That's to me is the telltale sign. He turns it in, and that's a direction.
Well, here goes.
It gives him the help.
Upon video review, the puck deflects off the player's skate. There is no distinct kicking motion. It's a good hockey goal.
So the goal stands. And McClement will get credit for his fifth of the year at 17:41 of the first period.
That surprises me a little bit because perhaps the National Hockey League, Mike Murphy and Kuda, don't think that's a kicking motion when you turn your heel towards the net.
So 1-1 the score. And it's a couple of nights in a row. The Islanders have gotten the short end of some close decisions. McLeady now for Grabner, who has the Islander goal. Carolina's outshot the Islanders 17-7. And Grabner now moves ahead. Just throws one at Ward. Not a bad idea after a little layoff to force the goaltender to handle the puck right away.
And make sure you keep the puck ahead of you. And I think one of the things that's going to happen when they get in that dressing room is the coaching staff going to talk about, you know, the turnovers. Quickly, just inside the blue lines, Howard, at night, in both blue lines, the Islanders weren't anywhere near as strong as they need to be. And that's one of the things that's going to make a difference in this game is whether you manage that puck. I call it turnovers at the blue lines, and the Islanders were the weakest part of their game in this period.
So Tavares and Jordan Staal will lean in. Anders Lee angled up in the corner. Ainsy takes the puck. Terry and Malone get the assists on the goal by McClinic. His fifth of the year. Minute 30 remaining in the period. Lee or Bailey trying to get away from Falk. Now to Hamonic closing in. Feeds Lee. Save made by Ward.
Just been a little bit tight. Could have stopped just a little bit sooner, would have had a better chance to score.
2-on-1 developing. Semin, though, snaps it off of Hamonic. He had Jordan Staal with him with just one Islander back. And Tavares now goes across. Hamonic's pass didn't reach Tavares. Eric Staal throws it around the boards. We reach the final minute of this first period. Hurricanes keep it deep. Hickey worked it the other way, intercepted by Gerby, played it through the crease. Belmore did not shoot, so Hickey squeezed by Rask in the corner. Nelson in there as well for the Islanders. Long with Nestrasil. And the Hurricanes keep it. Now Rask, pinned by Nelson. Rask keeps moving. Bailey reaching. But again, the Hurricanes able to keep the puck in the Islanders' zone as it was wristed around the boards by Lyles. Down to 16. Remaining in this first period. Kuhlman plays it in. Belmore back to get it. And now Rask with 7 to go. So Lyles, watched by Strome, simply wheels it to the far side as time runs out in the first period. First period where the Hurricanes controlled large stretches of play. They outshot the Islanders 18-9. Although Grabner got the Islanders the first goal of the game. That was at 11:47. McClement evened it up at 17:41. So 1-1 at the end of one.
And for me, Howie, the shots are not really an indication of the period. A lot of shots on the outside by the Hurricanes, but as I mentioned earlier on, the Islanders will talk about the turnovers at the blue line and try to play a little more structured game. Spend more time in the offensive zone.
All right, we're going to talk shots and suds in our Ford intermission report, which is coming up. Shannon will visit with Michael Grabner, who has the Islander goal. And then they're going to talk about a local brew. We'll have highlights, too. It's coming up next. Getting set to start the second period. Not a night on MSG Plus. Join Bill Pito, EJ Raddick, Steve Valiquette, and Mike Bossy as they break down the local hockey scene and go around the NHL. Hockey Night Live tonight at 11:30 p.m. on MSG Plus. Mike Bossy had a nice sit-down with John Tavares. You'll enjoy that, as well as our Cadillac trivia question. Cam Ward, the goaltender for the Hurricanes, was born on February 29, 1984, leap year, of course. And two Islanders made their debut that same game against the Winnipeg Jets. This is not one of the tougher ones we've asked. No. I don't think.
No, but this is one of the easier ones. Our crackpot crew.
Well, that can go a lot of ways, you know. Crackpot can be a very vague term.
Well,
so, state your intentions. Anyway, if you don't know the answer, we'll have it for you a little bit later on. I mean, it was 31 years ago, so shouldn't expect that everybody would necessarily know it. Well, offside, and keep your shirts on. We'll answer it a little bit later, not 10 seconds into the period.
Could I say they both played for their national team? Would that help out?
Well, it would help those who might not have known it already, but that's not giving it to them, though, because, again, you know, we tend to take for granted sometimes that there are people even younger than we are who might not remember it at first guess. But here's Hillen firing, and the save made by Johnson.
Another good start for the Hurricanes. Getting the puck into the offensive zone with the good jump, good puck retrieval, using their points to create offense. Bill Peters looking for his team to drive towards the net. He acknowledged that that's the way you're going to score goals in this league, is to drive into those dirty areas, screen, take the hacks and the whacks, look for the rebounds, the deflections.
Well, from the draw, Hainsey steers it towards the corner. It wasn't held there initially by Nestrosil. And the Islanders work it to center, but Nestrosil gets it again and banks one up the right side to Rask. Hickey's with him. Nielsen spins the puck around the board.
If you watch the Hurricanes play, they stay up on the forwards a lot more than they did earlier on in the year, making it much more difficult to get through the neutral zone.
And a penalty coming up here. I would imagine this is going to be against the Islanders, if only because Ward had started towards the Carolina bench, but they didn't blow the whistle until a Hurricane was about to play the puck. But it is going to be against New York, an interference penalty on Thomas Hickey.
He wasn't sure, because he was just trying to sneak off the ice, one of two. Well, I guess that would be cause a pretty good interference call on Rask. Puck bounced away on Thomas Hickey, so he did the next best thing, is make sure that Hurricane player couldn't get to it. It was a good call by the referees.
58 seconds of the second period is when the call comes, and Islanders penalty killing, improving, as you see.
Yeah, 20 out of their last 22. Gave up two goals in the same game against the Canucks.
So the Hurricanes set up a shot from a deep angle, did not get through. And now back at the line, Rask across, and the drive by Falk was blocked away. Nestrosil around now for Eric Staal. Rask to Falk. Back across Staal. A save made. Rebound. Falk shoots. He scores. A power play goal for Justin Falk. His 12th goal of the year. And the Hurricanes take a 2-1 lead.
And the Islanders give up a seam pass all the way across, and that created the problems. And Chad Johnson was out a little further, couldn't get back and cut off that short side pass. A little bit of a fortuitous bounce off the original shot, but Justin Falk continues to improve his game. There's the seam pass, quick shot on net, and again Chad Johnson, not able to control that rebound, and then was a little slow getting across as he steps to push off and took a couple of pushes off the knee. Needed to get across a lot quicker on that particular play.
So at 1:26 of the second period, Carolina with their fifth power play goal against the Islanders this year, have a 2-1 lead. Now a backhander goes wide. And it was taken from the slot by Lindholm.
This looks like a game for me, Howie, that the Islanders are going to have to grind it out, because certainly the Hurricanes are skating very well, but Islanders having a tough time getting themselves into it mentally.
The Hurricanes is a team that traveled last night. Even though the Islanders and Hurricanes both played, Islanders stayed home.
The Hurricanes have played much better, and I asked Bill Peters, why are you guys playing a little bit better now? And so quite simply, is because they were a little healthier, obviously with the Stalls being hurt, and
said, in the chemistry, we're trying to get, finally getting some lines that can play together and then starting to trust one another. And then he said, you know, I was trying to bring in a new system with all these injuries and we weren't having much luck. And if you're not winning, Howie, nobody buys into the system. So now they're starting to win. Now it becomes a little easier to buy into the system.
Eric Staal and Rask picked up the assists, and the Hurricanes off to another good start. They had the first 10 shots of the first period. They've outshot the Islanders 6-1 here in the second, and 24-10 for the game already.
And it's been a long time since the Islanders have been outshot like this in the first period or so.
Ward's pass nearly picked off completely by Clutterbuck. Eventually, he finds Strait, who shoots, saved by Ward. And Clutterbuck keeps the puck in the Carolina zone. Worked around to Grabner now. He's got the Islander goal, as Michael Grabner. Grabner again. Hard feed to Hamonic. Across to Strait. Looking for Nielsen, who recovers but can't hold on to it. Nielsen back to it. Snaps one wide. And it's banked off the boards, not out. Hamonic's backhander sails over the crossbar.
And this is where the Islanders need to play, simply because the weakness of this particular hockey club is on the defense. We only have one real good bet, and that's Justin Falcon. He's a young guy. I mean, you lose Tapera, you lose Gleason. This is where you need to play, and this is where turnovers become even more critical. Chip the puck in and go to work, and the Islanders, nice shift there by the Franz Nielsen line.
Well, Tavares gets the puck deep, but the Hurricanes next to play it, and so they come to center, led by Jordan Staal. He's taken in cleanly by Hickey. Eric Staal knocked down by Lee. Now Jordan Staal towards the blue line to Falk. Tavares got in the way of that. Jordan Staal again dances towards the slot, flips one that winds up in the glove of Johnson.
Well, Jordan Staal starting to find his game. He's only played a 22 games. He comes back off that major surgery on his, I believe it was his lower body, how, and he's just finally starting to skate. He's a terrific young player. Big money coming in from Pittsburgh, but you can see him deacon in the diving out there. But coach was saying this, the way he's been skating the last half a dozen games is a big change, and obviously very happy with his progress.
A rarity, the Islanders being outshot as drastically as they are. They had taken 383 more shots than their opponents coming into this one, but they've been outshot by 13 with 4:13 gone here in the second period. 2-1 Carolina. Rask across to Gerby, and a save by Johnson. Gerby again, quick shot. Johnson the save, bats the rebound away, and it's worked out of the zone. Now to Strome, in over the line, throws one to the net, but Ward steers to the corner. Islanders recover. Nelson put one behind Letty, who's scrambling just to maintain some kind of position, never mind possession. And the Hurricanes bank it out to center. It's Gerby sending Rask into the Islanders zone against Letty. Victor Rask turns it over. But Bellemare has it back.
Almost too many men on the ice. As you mentioned, Rask turning the puck over as his team was changing. Always dangerous to play around the short side.
Guy named Bellemare really should play for the Islanders, at least as long as they're in Nassau County, right?
Yeah. Bellemare Park, is that what it is?
Yeah, well, one of those two. And here's a lead by Nash that goes unplayed by Skinner. Icing's been waved off.
Yeah, I'm not sure why they waved that off. Johnny Boychuk wasn't really in position to get that.
Well, Johnson was to get the shot from Nash, and there's no further play.
The Islanders are just seem to be a little bit out of sync. A lot of different elements of their game haven't come together. As we watch Jack Capuano marking a couple things on the board, Islanders have not been the quicker team, and not many teams can come into the Nassau Coliseum and outskate the Islanders. But up to this point in time, you'd have to say the Hurricanes are skating much better than the Islanders.
So Jordan Staal wins a draw from Mollerat. And now Simmon fields it back to Staal in the corner. Worked over a bit by Strait, who got knocked down by Eric Staal. Eric with a puck here.
First line against fourth line for the Hurricanes.
Staal to Simmon. Jordan Staal towards the front of the net, but that's cut off by Johnson, and he'll hold on. It'll be another face-off, the game that's been filled with him.
Well, the big Staals both large in size and large in ability and able to be very, very strong. Play heavy down below the goal line, as Peters and his former head coach, Mike Babcock, would talk about, being able to control the puck below the goal line. Stahls gave you an indication of their abilities.
Everything comes back around to relevance, doesn't it?
Yes.
Heavy was a term in the late 60s and early 70s. Now it's a hockey term. Do we give Babcock credit for this one, too?
Well, maybe his favorite group was the Hollies.
Nice. Anders Lee to Bailey. And a pass for Tavares. A little too hard. Now Bailey working the corner. Lyles got it loose. The defenseman, John Michael Lyles, in some trouble here. But now it's slammed out of the zone by Malone. Malone's drive is knocked aside, or this is Malone getting to it now, as Lindholm took that shot. He came out of the corner. Johnson got a piece of it.
Brad Malone, his uncle was Greg Malone, a former Pittsburgh Penguin. Brad's favorite player was, you can guess then, Mario Lemieux.
Now Tavares trying to slip away from Faulk. Now trying to feed the blue line. Nestor Sill prevents that.
And there's that matchup, Howie, I've been talking about with Faulk and Hainge. More often than not, out against the John Tavares line. They'll look to change first opportunity they get.
Johnny Boychuk works it ahead for Strome, but he's well covered by Hainsey. That's onside as Strome knocks it down legally. Grabner shoots. That got through. Ward made a save and might not have realized it at first. He certainly couldn't find the rebound afterwards.
Positional save, Howie. Just knew where the puck was and positioned himself in the middle of the net.
12:40 remaining, second period.
Second period, the Hurricanes lead the Islanders 2-1. Well, the National Hockey League made some changes. Remember Thomas Vanek in front of the net with Halak. This goal here was disallowed. A kicking motion. Now some things changed over the year. The NHL certainly made an adjustment. That goal now counts. Little help. Still can't buy it. Wasn't a kicking motion for me, but that's what the National Hockey League did. They looked at what Thomas Vanek was up against. Halak's in the building. He might have a different opinion. We'll have to ask him, Howie.
But yeah, the Islanders are still waiting to have one of those ruled in their favor.
Yeah, so that's two in a row for them from that perspective.
But, you know, the league has had this initiative the last couple of years to increase scoring at every opportunity. So, yeah, they're giving a little more latitude to that now. But
yep.
There is interpretation always. And the way that was interpreted in Toronto gave McClement credit for the tying goal. And the Hurricanes have since taken the lead. It's 2-1 Carolina. Justin Faulk with a go-ahead goal. We're 8 minutes into the second period.
And Mike Murphy was telling me that they showed videos in the offseason in the summer with the 30 GMs. 15 said this was a goal. 15 said this wasn't a goal. So, I mean, that's, you know, through one's eyes can change things dramatically.
And again, they're kind of trying to err on the side of more offense or more goals anyway.
Beauty is in the eyes of the beholder, I guess.
Eric Staal down for Semin, and he gave it away. Kuhlman moving to center against Bellemare. Got a piece of Kuhlman. Now Lyles back to play the puck. He's checked immediately by Nikolai Kuhlman. Islanders keep it. Kuhlman keeps the legs moving. Now Nelson looks for Clutterbuck. Hamonic lets one go. Save made by Ward. He left a rebound that Nelson couldn't reach. Kuhlman has it back. Clutterbuck in the corner. Gets away of a good portion of that hit by Bellemare. And the Hurricanes get it again. Jordan Staal ahead to his brother Eric. Moves to the Islander line. And Carolina changes on the move. Shots are 29-14 Hurricanes. Not yet. Halfway through this game, 40 seconds shy of that. Close to a 60-shot pace are the Hurricanes.
Well, if you want to get the puck towards the net and you have people crashing the net, the Hurricanes have done a pretty good job with that so far.
Now it's Tavares working it back to the blue line to straight. Wrist shot, blockered away.
Cam Ward was able to pick that one up.
It's pretty aggressive on that one.
Yeah, but he had some people in front of him. He had Bailey and Lee. Cam Ward fought it off.
Now here's a pass across, and they score. This time it's McClement doing it without any controversy. Jay McClement's second goal of the game. Carolina leads 3-1.
Yeah, he only has 4 goals coming into this game, so he's not an offensive juggernaut, but a good quick release on that pass as he came off the bench. Found himself all alone. Lots of change, and he's going to come right off and through the bench for U.S. City. Hurricanes were able to get it. Gerby protects the boards. There's the quick pass. McClement just comes off the bench, and that's the hardest guy to pick up, as I've said on a number of occasions. Terry makes the quick pass across. And McClement just zips it into the net in a hurry.
So it is 3-1 now for the Hurricanes as Molerat chips it back to DeHaan in the Islanders' zone. And the Islanders have not been on their heels as much as they have been in this game in a long, long time.
They just, again, haven't been able to find their mojo, and credit the Hurricanes, who played a very solid period so far. Game also.
DeHaan tried to throw it to the net. Didn't get there. DeHaan's got it again. Now McDonald shoots, and that's gloved and held by Cam Ward. So, 2 goals for McClement, 3-1 Hurricanes. Download MSG Go, the only app that lets you watch MSG Network's coverage of live Knicks games anywhere. Download now at the App Store or Google Play. MSG Go is currently available to Optimum subscribers. So the Islanders down 2. They have John Tavares on the ice right now, and his play starts today in the NHL by virtue of having more goals, 29, than Backstrom, Kane, or Voracek. For Voracek, John Tavares starts play leading the league in scoring. Perfect on faceoffs. We give him 9 out of 9 there as Hamonic comes down the boards. And John Tavares in position to win the Art Ross Trophy.
Number 18, Jay McClement.
It's a long way to go, of course. This is game 64 of the 82-game schedule for the Islanders.
At least he gives himself an opportunity. How we talked about 15 games ago, wasn't in the top 10.
Now straight puts it off of Ward, takes a big hop, and lands right at the Carolina line, and is brought ahead by Semin. Thought about a shot, now fires and missed on the stick side.
You're talking about John Tavares and the faceoffs. A few years ago, he was down around 48%, an area that he's worked hard to become a lot better. Obviously, when you get a little more experience, learn some of the other centermen, and with John, a little more strength to his game.
Now Tavares put it right through the crease. Nestrosil and Gerby, by the way, got the assists on McClement's 6th and 2nd of the game at 9:50.
Well, that was a great pass by Nestrosil, putting in the right area.
Now Stroma shot steered away by Ward. Elmore cuts it off behind the net. 8:19 to go here in the second period. Islanders down 2. And Skinner for Carolina. Pings it up the right wing. Lindholm pulls up. Slips it back to the corner. Nielsen gets there ahead of Skinner. And Grabner fails to clear. Nash kept it alive. Nielsen against a pair of Hurricanes.
Skinner and Lindholm, both youngsters.
Rask in there as well. Squirts loose. And up comes Nielsen looking for Strom. Tried to get to the inside against Hillen, but didn't have control of the puck. And Jack Hillen makes a nice play. And carries through and over the Islander line. Now for Rask. He didn't get anything on that wind around. So DeHaan ahead for Clutterbuck with 7:17 to go in the second.
Good job of back checking by Gerby. Nelson thought he had him beaten. Gerby stayed with it and able to steal the puck back.
That's worked ahead by Yordan. And now Hickey. Around but not out. Long drive goes wide as Malone let one go.
I think that went off of DeHaan in front of the net. Never got to Chad Johnson.
Butterbuck's pass almost picked off there by Terry. And the Islanders continue their sloppy ways in this one with 6:37 to go in the second.
And it hurts when the fourth line gets a couple of goals. Certainly a bonus for the Hurricanes, but from an Islander perspective, You don't like the fourth line to be, it would be the line that beat you. Although we've seen it a number of times for the Islanders on the opposition.
32-18 in shots for Carolina. McDonald racing after it, but Hillen gets to it first.
Big part of Jack Hillen's game's always been his speed, his competitiveness.
Malone curls it to the far side. Semin got to it first. Jordan Staal behind the net. Out towards the boards. Eric Staal's shot stopped by Johnson, and he'll hold on. 5:54 remaining second period. Hurricanes by two.
Back here at Nassau Coliseum, the Islanders trailing the Carolina Hurricanes 3-1 the score. But coming up on the Chevrolet intermission report, Anson Carter sitting down with two hockey pioneers, Willie O'Ree and Val James, who really helped set the stage for African-American and black players in the hockey world. That's coming up in the Chevrolet intermission report, but still some time to play here in the second period, guys.
All right, thanks, Shen. You see the Islanders wearing those pretty popular alternate jerseys. I don't imagine they'll be going away as of next year. We keep hearing that the next alternate jersey will be black for black's sake, which, of course, not an Islanders color, but those are the signals we keep getting. And these are probably, as Eric Staal drives one that's stopped by Johnson, I would submit these are probably the most popular alternate jerseys the Islanders have ever had. And boy, what a shame if they are relegated to the scrap heap.
Yeah, now Brooklyn, as I understand it, there'll be a third jersey will be more of a resembling the Brooklyn population, if you will, Howie. And the Islanders will maintain their tradition with their standard white and orange uniforms that we all enjoy.
Now from the draw, Lyles lays it to the corner, and Johnson had the post protected there against Nestrosil. Now Lyles with a wrist shot, and it's scooped up by Johnson with 5:19 remaining in the second period. That's not been one of the Islanders' better ones.
The Islanders just can't seem to kick it into another gear. It's not like they're, you know, the effort's not there and they're skating okay, but they can't find that extra gear that we've seen them so often, you know, play with, that blazing speed. Really what the rest of the National Hockey League is continually talking about is the speed of the Islanders. It just hasn't surfaced into the game so far tonight, except for the goal by Michael Grabner.
Now Hainsey winds one around to the far side. Brian Strait worked it up the boards. And Semin plays catch with Eric Staal. Staal chops it in back to the near corner. Alex Semin's been such a bust in Washington, or was in Washington, now here in Carolina. Kuhlman to the net, shoots, he scores! Nikolai Kuhlman, the former teammate of Semin's in Washington. It'll have beat him back up the ice.
That is just a tremendous individual effort. Eric Staal tried to stay with Kuhlman, but he would not be denied as he kept his feet moving. He used the strength. He's such a strong individual. There's the quick puck movement up to the side. And again, watch Kuhlman. He just pushes off and then gets the puck to his forehand. Staal tries to come back hard. There's Dustin Falk. Look at the strength. He just pushed him over like he was a teenager. What a move by Kuhlman. And that is a huge goal for the Islanders as this period comes down to the last 5 minutes. This will certainly kick him into gear.
That was the goal that Kuhlman needed as badly as the Islanders. For Nikolai Kuhlman, his first goal in 18 games. Bailey, a little angry. He just had the stick slashed out of his hands and broken.
Yeah, the referee missed that particular scenario.
Now the Islanders down one. DeHaan for Tavares. He missed it in the corner. Nash tried to spin it around the boards. Lee got it back. Tavares around the net.
Stick playing havoc with all of the guys, and their stick handling down low.
That is Bailey's broken stick. DeHaan holds the puck in. Ward steers it away. Lands in the trapezoid. Hickey comes down the boards. Skinner recovers the puck, banks it that way, but Hickey gets back, and in turn is backed up by Letty. Butterbuck and Hamonic assist. On the goal by Kuhlman at 15-11. 3-2 Hurricanes. Tavares looking for a play from behind the net. hard to the slot beyond the reach of Martin.
They're looking for Matt Martin, who's out on that slot area. Islanders looking to make a change, but renewed energy for the Islanders on that big effort from Kuhlman.
So here comes Nick Leddy up to the Carolina line. Plays it around the boards. Comes right to the stick of McClement, who's got two goals tonight. Malone unable to squeeze by. And up comes Martin. Matt Martin trying to get past Hillen now. Also runs rather hard into your Dunn. But McClement starts the Hurricanes to center. Moving to the Islander line, away from the sweep check of McDonald, picked up by Martin, who takes him in well. Lyle's in there as well. Hamonic working him over. Pardon me, that's Terry, number 25. Hamonic on Terry, Martin on McClement. And all the while, the puck stays loose.
You got to keep your emotions in check, make sure you don't take a penalty. Very aggressive play by Travis Hamonic as he was wailing away on Terry. One more fight to the Islanders inside the blue line along the boards, Howie. Picked up their intensity.
Yeah, that Kuhlman goal got them going and the fans. But here's Nestrasil firing. They score! Johnson thought he had it. He didn't. And Malone batted it through. It is 4-2 Carolina. A buzzkill of a goal.
A huge goal with just a couple minutes to go. Islanders making a change. Michael Grabner couldn't get back in. It was a 3-on-2 for the Hurricanes. It was an outside shot. Johnson made the initial save but couldn't squeeze it. Look at the Islanders coming in off the bench. There's the quick pass. And Nestor still goes 5-hole. And oh, thank you very much. They don't become a lot easier than that. Shot by Nestor still goes 5-hole through the Jed Johnson's legs. And it's Malone that taps it in. That's a 2-inch putt, Howie. That's how easy that goal was.
2:35 after the Kuhlman goal, and that quiets the crowd down. But here's a chance in front. Strome had two shots at it. Couldn't get either one of them through.
Blocked by Jordan.
Grabner working behind the net now. Grabner in front, but that shot by Nielsen was blocked. Here's Strome teeing it up. And he went short side and missed. Well, this shift, pretty good one for the Islanders in that they get three or four good opportunities, but now they're going to take a penalty. Looks like Strome will go after Malone's 10th from Nestrasil and Lyles at 17:46. Made it 4-2 Carolina. Strome will head to the penalty box for a high stick.
Yeah, terrific shift for those guys. Ryan Strome with a couple of opportunities and along with Franz Nielsen. I mean, they're out in front with great chances to score. And there's the high stick. Ryan Strome on Rask. Easy call for the referees, but just prior to that, two or three really good opportunities down low. Either Jordan blocked him or he got hit by him.
Hurricanes scored on their first power play. Eric Staal tees one up. Put it over the net. Hickey back to get it. And Thomas Hickey clears. Hurricanes had four shots en route to their power play goal.
Well, the Islanders, you have to wonder, Howie, if they'd be able to kill this penalty off of this period, whether we'll see Halak in the net, because Chad Johnson has not had a good game.
Now Boychuk fires one hard around. Past Falk and all the way down. It's an interesting call, too, because Johnson's played so well lately, and games have piled up the way they have so that the Islanders are happy to give Halak this afternoon off with the next game not until Tuesday. I wonder, does that send an uncomfortable message to Chad Johnson, or does that even matter?
I mean, well, it does matter. I mean, Chad Johnson has earned his starts. He's played, as you mentioned, Howie, very well in his last four, but he has not played particularly well in this particular start. And yeah, you wonder, does that give pause for thought?
It's an interesting call. That puck caroms out of play. 31.8 left in the period. 52 seconds on the Strome penalty, which carries over unless the Hurricanes score. And Yaroslav Halak expecting the afternoon off. Maybe that will come under review.
Well, the Hurricanes are certainly a more fresh team, Howie. And I don't mean it just being for one particular game. The Hurricanes haven't gone through the vigorous schedule that the Islanders have over the last little while. And you have to wonder, you know, is this catching up with them a little bit tonight?
Well, we were talking to Jack Capuano about that before the game. This is their 18th game in 33 days. The schedule just does not get any more compressed than that. But they'll play 18 games, the remainder of their schedule, over the final 42 days, which means take a breath and roll downhill a little bit.
And it makes a difference, as we've seen in the National Hockey League.
Chance in front, they score! Yordan on the power play with 7.8 seconds remaining in the second period, and the Hurricanes have taken a 5-2 lead.
Good puck movement by the Hurricanes. Again, as they're able to get control, create some offensive opportunities. This puck goes right through the crease, up high. There's a quick, nice bounce, and that puck goes right through the crease. I talked to Dunny about that, as to who's got to control that, and it's the goaltender that has to be able to control his own crease, and that was a pass right through, and Jordan, his second goal of the season. Hurricanes can do no wrong. That puck caromed. There we go, Matt Martin's wondering what happened there.
Well, the clock stopped at 4.7. They started to run it again, and the whistle blew immediately, and I'm not sure how they're going to figure this out. 2.4 shows on the clock right now. Just watch the top of the screen here with Martin.
Oh, he was... Belmore. Yeah, they had been talking, and Belmore didn't want anything to do with it, so Matt Martin must have been talking to him earlier on.
Belmore simply goaded Martin into dropping the gloves.
You can't make that change now. Belmore can't come off the ice when they're redoing the faceoff, I don't think.
Well, the clock now says 2.4, and they're talking to Jeff Weintraub, the supervisor of the off-ice officials over at the scores table, presumably about simply putting the clock back to what I think should be 4.7.
Well, if they put it back to 4.7, now they're just going to
run it out altogether. So what they're saying is that while all that mishigas was going on, for whatever reason, the clock didn't run. Now they run it out, and it doesn't appear there'll be any penalties. But the Islanders have a lot of work to do headed towards the third period as they trail 5-2.
Well, they found some energy after the terrific effort by Kuhlman, and then they just let him get away. Zach Capuano trying to get clarification from the referees.
Yeah, Jack was just asking 5-on-5. He wanted to know from Graham Skilleter, the referee, are we 5-on-5 to start the third period? I think he answered in the affirmative, but I couldn't tell. Well, anyway, a big second period for the Hurricanes as they take a 1-1 tie and turn it into a 5-2 lead. The Chevy Report is next. Can't blame Jack Capuano for not having liked what he has seen, as our Tri-Honda recap shows you partway how the Hurricanes have built this 5-2 lead over the Islanders with the third period about to begin. The Islanders giving up two power play goals against, and Matt Martin will in fact begin the third period in the penalty box, but the Islanders will not be down a man. It's simply a 10-minute misconduct that Martin was given at the end of that second period. So it is, as Jack Capuano was inquiring about, 5-on-5 to start the third, and Chad Johnson is still in goal for the Islanders.
Well, you had to know that Matt Martin for him to drop his gloves. Belmore gave him every indication in the world that he was going to fight. Tricked him. Now Matty Martin's going to be in the box for 10 minutes.
And Clutterbuck makes a move towards the slot, working against Lyles. They turn each other around. And Kuhlman now, watched by Jordan Staal. So the Islanders have a big home ice comeback in them. They've played so well at home here most of the year. There have been a couple of dramatic comebacks. And this one would take everything they've got in that department, down 3 to start the third.
Well, they need one in the first 5 minutes to get themselves back into the game emotionally and get the crowd back into it, make them the sort of the sixth player, if you will, on the ice.
Havanick cruising through center, spins it around to the near corner. Back to the boards now, Letty, and he drilled his own man, Lee, with that.
A little high, Lee couldn't deflect it.
Letty tries again, and that's deflected by the stick of Nestrasil. Bailey behind the net, moving towards the corner, under intense pressure there. And the Hurricanes win the puck. It was a good job by the Hurricanes' Victor Rask, number 49, who follows to the corner. Nestrasil goes to the front of the net, but Lee picks the pass off.
Rask is strong along the boards and able to maneuver himself to be able to pick up that puck off the boards with Bailey.
Minute 40 gone in the third. Islanders have been outshot 36 to 19. Nielsen lets go a drive, and that's caught easily by Cam Ward. There'll be a faceoff in the Hurricane zone.
Well, you got to get the puck towards the net, and Franz Nielsen trying to maybe create a rebound or a possible, you know, shot back to the corner and let the Islanders get involved in their forecheck. Cam Ward aggressively gets outside that crease and uses his trapper, and hangs on and slows the play down.
Well, the faceoff deep in the Carolina zone, controlled by the Hurricanes. Islanders have Nielsen, Grabner, and Strome, with Hickey and DeHaan at the moment. Hickey and Hamonic had started as a defense pair today. And up comes Riley Nash, trying to get away from Grabner. Nash with a pass picked off by DeHaan, and the Islanders in transition don't get very far as Hickey's got to chase it back into his own zone. And the teams begin to change now. Nielsen throws one around the board. And the Islanders get straight back on defense with Hamonic. It's snapped off the side of the net. Malone to the corner now. Out to Belmore. Belmore throws it back towards that corner. Good hit delivered there by Brian Strait. But then there's going to be a penalty on the pull down of Malone.
Another high sticking call as the referee checks out Malone. We'll see if it's going to be two or four. Not sure who is getting the penalty.
Mollerat.
Yeah, Mollerat's getting the penalty. 4 minute penalty.
So a double minor indicated by the referee.
You see the scrambling around the net, and there's careless use of the stick as Mollerat tries to get past Malone. You got to get your stick down when you're going to make passage. That's just careless use.
It's a misnomer, by the way, that if you draw blood, it's an automatic penalty. It's, you know, if you sort of incidentally cut a guy slightly, that's not automatically an extra 2 minutes. Injury is the word that's used in the rule book, which mandates the extra two, and it was deemed that was serious enough that it could be called an injury. And so here's Rask letting go a drive. That hit Nielsen, he can't find it. The bouncing puck taken back and cleared all the way down by Kuhlman.
What does injury mean? You can't come back in one shift?
I don't know. That's what the rule book says, and it does create some room for interpretation if blood's not the automatic marker. That one goes off the glass and out of play. But remember, the Islanders have killed, or attempted to anyway, two penalties tonight, and the Hurricanes have scored on both power plays.
Yeah, two for two, and they were so good coming into this particular game. 20 of 22, and the only time they gave up a penalty was against Vancouver. They gave up both of those goals, so they had found a little bit of rhythm. Apparently, they've lost it again.
Jordan.
That's been their Achilles heel, Howie, all season long. I mean, where would this team be if it was in the top 10 amongst the penalty killers instead of 30th?
Well, right now, Jordan Staal up front with Semin and Skinner. Lyles carries on. The cross-ice feed to Yordun. Islanders have Hickey, Boychuk, Nelson, and Clutterbuck. Remember, this is a double minor, 2:53 remaining to the 4 minutes. The Hurricanes were to score before 2 minutes expire, then they get the full 2 minutes on the second penalty.
And you know they're going to be a little cautious with a three-goal lead. Not as aggressive as you might normally be.
Sent all the way down again. Grabner puts the heat on Ward. And that went off the stick of Ryan Strome.
It was very, very close for Ryan Strome to intercept it. He'd have had a tap in.
Grabner a chance to clear. He doesn't. It's held in at the line by Falk. Now to Semin. He just throws it into the corner. Too far for Jordan Staal to reach. And the Islanders can't clear. Falk slips a blind pass to the near side. And it comes out to center, and now Grabner. moves in over the line and throws it cross ice. They're still onside. Hickey had a man down low. It was Strome, but couldn't find him. Now we're into the second half of the double minor. So the Islanders get credit for a kill there.
Good work by Michael Grabner. Recognized he didn't have much gas left and just dumped it into the opening and created an offensive opportunity for his team. Good job of penalty killing.
Lindholm behind the net now, throws it out in front. A save made by Johnson on Eric Staal. With 1:34 remaining on the double-minded of Mollerat, there'll be a faceoff in the Islanders' zone.
Tough play for the goaltender whenever the puck is behind the net and shot back out in front, but from the opposite side, he's got to readjust himself and get out there, take away that near side, the post, get your shoulders up against it, get a nice job on the Staal attempt.
From the draw, Brock Nelson trying to move ahead, can't get it out. Hainsey keeps it in, and the Hurricanes trying to go to work here on the power play, but Dalvin DeHaan recovers the puck, and Nelson clears out to the center ice area. McClement is looking for a hat trick now. Taken to the boards by DeHaan. Slithers loose to Hamonic, and he gets rid of it.
Well, you have to... guessing that Clement hasn't had a hat trick in his career.
He has one, actually.
He does have, yeah. Crosses, yeah. Fourth liner. You know, his eyes are be wide open for the rest of the game.
Ryan straight slips it back. Nielsen spins it around and all the way down.
He's a good fourth line player, third line, fourth line player for the Toronto Maple Leafs as a checker also, penalty killer.
Islanders will be in Toronto during the upcoming road trip. Their only visit to the Air Canada Center this year. 35 remain on a double minor power play for the Carolina Hurricanes, which the Islanders have killed quite nicely so far. Up comes Falk. Put it around the board. Simmons there. Gave it up to Clutterbuck, who in turn gave it away. Eric Staal back for Jordan now. Jordan Staal leaves it for his brother. A bank feed to the blue line. Falk across, Staal looking for his brother in front. That's broken up and cleared by Hamonic, and that's going to take care of the penalties to Mollerat. And there's at least a little something for the Islanders to feel good about.
A little momentum possibly for the Islanders. A bad power play for the opposition sometimes leads to a little momentum for the team on the other side, which in this case is obviously the Islanders.
Well, Chad Johnson was telling his defense it was going to be icing. He was wrong, but the Islanders now move ahead, led by Bailey. Looks for Tavares. Tavares put it out in front, looking for Lee. Couldn't reach it. And the Hurricanes now with Hainsey going to Hillen in the corner. Hillen under pressure from Tavares. 12:40 remaining in the third. Thomas Hickey watched by Gerby, who instead peels away and heads to the bench as Carolina changes on the move. Islanders turn it over again. Nash with Lindholm in front. Now Skinner shoots, and that goes wide. It might have hit Letty on the way. And Hickey goes to the far side.
Three on two there for the Hurricanes after the turnover in the neutral zone.
Quick up by Belmore to Lindholm, and his shot a high riser, stopped by Johnson. Rebound Lindholm. That one looked like it hit straight. Islanders recover the puck, and it's brought on by Strome. Across now to Hamonic into the Hurricane zone. Put it out in front. Skinner was there, has some help in clearing, and this will go for an icing. 11:48 remaining in the third period. The New York Spring Spectacular, presented by Chase, stars the Rockettes. Laura Benanti from ABC's Nashville and Derek Hough from Dancing with the Stars in a dazzling musical celebration of New York City. It's on March 12th through May 3rd only at Radio City. For tickets, visit Rockettes.com/spring.
Well, I talked about the Hurricanes getting a little rest over the last little while, Howie. They've played three games in the last 7 days. The Islanders have played four. But it's the accumulation, I think, of the Islanders' schedule over this month of February that is starting to bite them. Carolina looks very refreshed. As I mentioned, a lot of jump yesterday, and Bill Peters was saying that he gave his team extra rest and starting to pay some dividends for them. At least they have the legs.
Now from the draw, the Hurricanes have the puck, too, as Nash banks it off the boards deep into the Islanders' zone. Carolina changing on the move now. Hamonic for Nelson. Makes one move around Terry. Still has three Hurricanes to beat. So he goes to the corner, looks for help. Lost the handle to the puck. Worked up by York Dunn and then swept cross ice by Terry.
Well, you know the Hurricanes are going to be back in full force, so you have to play the chip and chase game. Nothing's going to be easy for you.
And that'll be held by Cam Ward. 11-10 remaining third period. Hurricanes still up three. To our Cadillac trivia question, for Islander fans who remember back in the 80s, this is pretty much a slam dunk. Two Islanders made their debut February 29th of 1984 against the Winnipeg Jets. Fresh from the Olympics, Patrick Flatley and Pat LaFontaine.
Yes, I remember it well. Joining the hockey club in the...
Didn't they wear shoulder pads in those days? These guys all look like linemen now compared to those pictures of Flatley and LaFontaine. And by the way, Pat LaFontaine will be honored by the Islanders on March 24th, where they've honored several of their alumni this year.
That'll be a fun night and good for Pat LaFontaine. Does an awful lot of charity work in the area.
And I'm glad Butch's kind of patched things up with the Islanders and is now once again a part of the family, so to speak, because he was a big part of this franchise.
Tremendous career, Flatley. He was Pat Flatley, and excuse me, he was Pat LaFontaine, and Flatley was Patrick Flatley. I thought they were both Pats.
Letty's drive, stop, rebound, score! John Tavares, the NHL's leading scorer, has his 30th goal of the year. It is 5-3, Carolina, and stick around, still 10:25 to go in the third period.
Well, they got the goal they needed to really get some energy back in the building, and finally the Islanders were able to pick up the loose puck, a rebound. It's been one and done most of the game. Letty's able to get that shot through. Donnie Boychuk in deep, expecting to gamble. There's the shot, and not a good play by Ward as he doesn't handle that rebound very well. He's got to get it to the corner. He's got to angle that stick. Doesn't do it, and Rask is not able to handle John Tavares by side the net. So let's just see if the Islanders can really kick it into gear and get something going. If they could score another quick one, Howie, then you're talking about a hockey game.
Now you've got an icing against the Hurricanes. Tavares picks up his 30th. His career high is 31, so he's got a second 30-goal season. And at the moment, of course, a lot of games later on, but John Tavares leading the pack in the NHL. Certainly it's unfortunate that Patrick Kane will finish the season at 64 points.
A big loss for the National Hockey League, as I mentioned the other day, and a big loss for the Blackhawks. But the Islanders should be really energized with that particular goal. As I said many times, you know, you get a goal, all of a sudden you find your legs.
So now Ward behind the net. The crowd re-energized. You would imagine the Islanders as well. Strom trying to play it to the net. Didn't get there. Went off the skates of Nesterson. Just under 10 minutes to go in the third. Rask trying to clear. He does. Nielsen couldn't hold it in. Scooting ahead is Gerby. Quick shot. Johnson, a little unsteady, but manages to hold on. Gerby took a bump from Thomas Hickey. And Gerby, one of the relatively few players in the league that Hickey towers over. 9:39 to go in the third. It's 5-3 Hurricanes. Tuesday night on MSG Plus 2, the Islanders will be in Dallas to face the Stars. Live coverage begins at 8 p.m. with Visa Islanders game night. Islanders Stars Tuesday night on MSG Plus 2. Check MSG.com for channel locations. Coming up, the Foxwoods Final Five. Foxwoods excitement every day. Boy, Lindy Ruff was really ticked off at his goaltending last game. And behind the play.
They're calling too many men on the ice on that play. That was a set play off the face-off, and Jack Capuano is not too happy, but that was a set play. Lee comes off the bench and...
Islanders penalty, too many men on the ice.
Let's see what happens. Right off the face-off, watch who goes to the bench. And it's going to be a set play. Here's John Tavares heading towards the bench, and he's right there now. And there's the pass. And there's the Islander players. You can watch Tavares heads right to the bench. Can't see exactly when the forward left.
Well, that's an interesting call because they give him an awful lot of leeway.
So the Hurricanes go to their fifth power play, 2 for 4 with 6 shots. The Islanders earlier in this period killed off a double minor. Right now, with 9:17 to go in the third, the clock is not their ally. They've got Nielsen out there with Kuhlman, Boychuk, and Hickey, and now Carolina will change. Bill Peters sends out Jordan Staal, Jeff Skinner, Alex Semin, along with Lyles and Yordan as the point men. Tavares sitting out with too many men on the ice penalty. Yordan across. And Lyles swings it around the board.
Yeah.
Boychuk double teamed in the corner. Butterbuck in to even it out. And now Yordan. For Skinner, Jeff Skinner tees one up. His shot hit a leg. Yordan, who has a goal in this game, hounded by Clutterbuck, and the puck fired ahead. Grabner was unable to make contact with it.
Yeah, it was a bouncing puck. Johnny Boychuk trying to get it out in a hurry. It was a 2-on-1 with Clutterbuck and Grabner if the puck lies flat.
Jordan Staal now with a drop to Lyles. Semin back for Yordan. 56 to the power play. Hamonic away from Skinner and out of the zone. And the Islanders begin to change now. Brock Nelson jumps on. Bahan takes Semin down. Jordan Staal pulls up, holds the puck, swings it back to the blue line. Falk a shot blocked by Dahan. Rebound played towards the slot, but Skinner lost the handle. And then Semin's pass splits the point man. And that's as good as an Islander clear.
Not a very good play by Alexander Semin. You got to be sure when you're in the corner.
Semin, 2 goals this year in 36 games.
As good as he shoots the puck, that's, to me, is unbelievable.
Erik Staal now looking for space in the corner. 10 to the power play for the Hurricanes. Bouncing puck stays in. Nestrasil turning on straight. Nice sliding block by Boychuk, and here's Tavares out of the box. Not back in the play yet as Erik Staal unable to convert in front. Islanders chop it to center. Tavares waiting for it, but the Hurricanes waiting for him. And John gets some help from Strome back to Tavares. Nestrasil got in the way. 7:15 to go in the third. Islanders down 2. Strome put it out in front. Tavares knocked down, pleading for a call that doesn't come. And then the puck knocked down with a high stick. And the Islanders increasingly frustrated.
Now John Tavares headed towards the front of the net as Ryan Strome had it behind. Take a little look. Ryan Strome, top of your screen. Couldn't tell how hard a cross-check that was by number 27. Falk, watch this. There's the push right there. Tavares not happy with it. I mean, given the way the scenario is gone, you can understand what's happening there, and John's certainly very frustrated.
Now from the draw, Hickey fires it around the boards. Bailey behind the net couldn't play it, and Nielsen got a piece of a Hurricane. It was McClement as the puck goes back deep into the Islanders zone. Perry tried to center. McClement squeezed a shot that went off of Hickey. Remember, McClement with 2 goals. Nick Leddy being chased by Terry. Time becoming an increasing factor. Down to 6:35 remaining in the third. McClement in the corner. He and Lee turn each other around. And out come the Hurricanes. This is Malone. But he's angled away neatly by Hamonic.
Good job with Travis Hamonic outskating the forward Malone.
Now Hamonic looks for Tavares. Skinner picks it off. Jeff Skinner to the slot. Quick shot by Nash is blocked by Straight. And batted out by Anders Lee. Icing waved off. We're under 6 minutes to go in the third. Belmore slides one in. And Johnson, a little unsure at first, pushed it back to the corner. Islanders don't clear, but now Strome. Nice little slip feed to Nielsen. In on the right wing, crisscrosses with Grabner. Grabner a shot. Save made by Ward.
A real good save by Ward. Able
tracked that puck from the right side. Good low shot by Michael Grabner.
Nielsen's pass too far for Boychuk. So Johnson out for a quick up. And Grabner will send it back to DeHaan.
Four Hurricanes back over center ice.
They have flooded the neutral zone. And icing call. They'll bring it back into the Islander zone with 5:10 left in the third. After the game, you'll get reaction from Coach Capuano and the players, plus highlights and analysis on the Islanders postgame show presented by Mazda immediately following the action.
Kelvin DeHaan trying to get to the red line and get his feet moving in time. Just needed to make another step, if you will, Howie, to chip that puck in.
Now from the draw, backhander by Nestrosil went wide. And it's lofted out of the zone by Letty. And then the Hurricanes get it back, and it's played in by Nestrosil. Rask take it in by Letty. Hurricanes at the point now where they're content to cycle, keep the puck in that Islanders zone as much as possible, and take time off the clock. Now 4:42 remain.
Now they continue to forecheck pretty hard. Not backing away from the Islanders. Defense still pinching, so they're staying aggressive.
There's a lead for Kuhlman too far. Grabbed back by Yordun. Yordun's goal at the end of the second period was a real crusher. It's the one that made it 5-2 with just 8 seconds remaining on the power play.
And also the goal that after the Islanders have come back from being down 3-1. That fourth goal was a tough one too.
Yeah, that was Malone's just a couple minutes after the Islanders got it to Juan Anders Lee. He's going to get a penalty here, I believe, for pulling Semin down.
Yeah, it's not Semin, really a hook, yeah.
I thought he might have been looking at Semin as though to say, we're going to get you too for embellishment. But I think it's just Lee. 4:05 remaining, third period. I think they are both going to go. Well, they do get Semin for embellishing after being taken down by Lee.
Good hard work by Semin on the back check. Takes the puck away from Lee, a couple of hooks, and then I don't know if he was embellishing or he lost his edge, but it's a good call. But there, no doubt there's a hook, and certainly it helps a little bit. And Lee, not very happy. Yeah, look at this. Yeah, come on, you're bigger, you're stronger than that. But my little tug. Howie, you and I were just talking off camera, and I wondered if Jack Capuano with a 4-on-4 situation wouldn't pull his goaltender. That, in one sense, creates a 5-on-4 power play for you. You're down two goals, less than 4 minutes to go. I don't know, you get a better opportunity. It has some risk to it, but you're down two.
Well, we'll see once the Islanders, assuming they do, get this puck out of their own zone and head up ice. You're watching the Foxwoods Final Five. Foxwoods, excitement every day. Visit Foxwoods.com now. Drive from the blue line by Falk. Broke Tavares' stick. Hit JT's stick. Now John gets one from the bench. The Islanders do hustle to center. Johnson stays in goal for now. Hamonic in deep. Put it out in front behind Strome. Johnson has shown no inclination. And now here comes Eric Staal down the left wing firing one. And that was blocked by the stick of Nick Letty. And up comes Tavares, minute 4 to the 4-on-4. 3:06 left in the third. Letty to Tavares, that slapped away. And Gerby chips one along to Rask. 2-on-1 developing, joining his Lyles, but Rask can't get it there. So Victor Rask under some pressure. He was outnumbered, and the Islanders changing. Nobody could touch the puck.
And a good smart move by Rask. He didn't throw the puck aimlessly, just hung on to it and forced the Islanders to take it off him. But that's a good defensive play when you're up a couple of goals in the offensive zone.
Half minute left to the 4-on-4. Islanders down 5-3. We've got 2.5 left in the third. Johnson edging out. He's going to go to the bench. Islanders pull the goaltender. They've got an extra skater. Their net is empty. Ward trying to gather it in does, although Nielsen took a poke at it. And so 20 seconds remain on the penalties to Lee and Semin. 2:24 left in the third. The Islanders trailing by two. Pull Chad Johnson.
And you wonder if he'll take a timeout. Yeah, Jack Capuano will take the timeout. 20 seconds. So the faceoff will be really important, Howie, for the Islanders to be able to get control right off the bat. See if they can't make something happen when they've pulled the goal. John Tavares has been very good on faceoffs, 12-2.
He's been the only one.
Yeah, everybody else has been lifeless as far as the faceoffs a concern, but I thought Jack might have pulled him a little earlier. Again, talking about the advantage of five on four, as you can see Doug Waite now waving down to a couple of the guys and wants Letty down there. Basically, this is going to be a power play. It'll be a five on four for a short bit and then a six on five. Doug Waite's going to want them to get something going, and it's got to happen in a hurry. You got to score two goals in your last couple of minutes of play.
So Johnson will keep the mask on for now, just in case he's got to go back at some point.
Let's see who takes the faceoff. It is Tavares, and he's been good, and this is a time when he needs to be very good.
Tavares has his 30th goal of the year in this period. He's made it 5-3. Well, the Islanders going with an empty net, a 5-on-4 skating advantage, which becomes 6-on-5 in 17 seconds. Hurricanes try to clear. Letty keeps it in. Floats it to the corner. Bailey gets to it. Bailey keeps working. Has help now from Nielsen. Tavares loose now moves into that little scrum and takes the puck. Quick feed. Nielsen missed the net. What a quick pass by Tavares. So the 4-on-4 is over. Now it's a 6-on-5 for the Islanders with a goaltender pulled and a minute 57 to go in the third.
Cam Ward came out in a hurry on that try by Franz Nielsen and didn't have much to shoot at, Holly, so it was a good aggressive play.
Anders Lee, ridden by Hainsey to the corner. Rask fires it ahead, and now Semin bottled up. So Bailey grabs the puck to the corner. As his pass intercepted by Falk, kept in the zone by Boychuk. He was knocked down by Eric Staal. All of this taking valuable time off the clock. Minute 27 to go. Bailey behind the net for Tavares. John looked to slide it in front. That didn't get through. And Eric Staal finds Semin. He'll chip it into the Islanders' zone. Letty in a race with Rask. They bump. Rask keeps working. Gets knocked down. Puck is underneath them. Clock keeps moving. A minute 7 to go in the third. Islander net is empty. They are down by 2. And Thomas Hickey leads them to center as we hit the final minute. Hickey wheels it around the boards. Dillon stops it there. Recovered by Hamonic. And now thrown from the blue line. Grabbed by Kuhlman and a stick save made by Ward. 45 seconds remain. Ryan Strome. There's traffic in front. Strome plays it across. Now Tavares gets it back from Kuhlman. 35 to go. Tavares for Strome. Strome gets a piece of it. Knocked off balance. Puck back out to center. 27 left on the clock. This is Hamonic now to the red line. Stopped behind the net by Ward with 17 to go. And the Islanders appear on their way to a home ice loss. Would be just their 9th of the year. But we're into the final 10 seconds now. The Islanders will not sweep the season series from the Carolina Hurricanes. Your final score this afternoon, Carolina 5 and the Islanders 3. The Islanders outshot 41-24, although the third period, each team managed only 5 shots.
Yeah, it was just a game where they just never seemed to be able to get their mojo. Howie, and the Hurricanes had good jump. They were on their toes the entire games. They outshot the Islanders, you mentioned, 41-24. And really, at the end of the day, they were the better team. Yes, the Islanders pushed a little bit at the end, but it was the Hurricanes who did a lot of good things and made the most of their opportunities and won the special teams battle.
So Carolina wins it 5-3. Let's take a look at our Newsday play of the game. This is the one that turned the momentum permanently in the direction of the Carolina Hurricanes. The Islanders had just cut the lead to 3-2, but then Chad Johnson failed to hold on here. And Malone batted the loose puck home. That's our Newsday play of the game. Discover the power of Newsday. Get the latest sports news on the go at newsday.com/apps. Our stars of the game, sponsored by your Tri-State Land Rover dealers. McClement, a two-goal game for Carolina. John Tavares, at this instant, is the undisputed leader in points in the NHL. He came up with his 30th goal. So we'll recap it all in just a moment or two on the Mazda Islanders postgame. Carolina Hurricanes in their final visit to the Coliseum come away 5-3 winners.